The Saul Zaentz Innovation Fund is a great resource for local filmmakers to bring their stories to light. The nonprofit brings us new voices, new outlooks, and new approaches to filmmaking by giving filmmakers grants and professional guidance. Investigative journalist Catherine Rentz has been reporting on what happens when Baltimore police begin testing rape evidence that a local doctor saved for decades. Her coverage is being turned into a short documentary, and she joins me this morning to talk about what she has found and how you can watch Open Secrets. Good morning, Catherine. Welcome to Maryland Perspectives.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
First of all, I just want to congratulate you on becoming a 2020 fellow at the Innovation Fund. What was that process like for you becoming a fellow?
Oh, it was fantastic. I recently just spent a weekend with some of the best documentarians and filmmakers across the country and in Baltimore there at the JHU MICA Center at the old Center Theater on North Avenue. And it was amazing to have some of these people pick apart your pitch, your documentary pitch or your film pitch, and give you advice. It's the kind of thing that you would normally pay thousands of dollars for to go to a workshop and have your work workshopped by somebody else, but it's super helpful. And, you know, you feel good about it because they are doing something that is great for Baltimore. They're growing the filmmaking industry here, and they're helping Baltimoreans tell stories about what's happening here. And some of them are, quite frankly, really, really interesting. And I think the audience will find them, some of them, pretty shocking.
Sure. And it's a great way of creating empathy for the plight of what a lot of people have to go through to live in the city, you know, and
right.
Especially for people like me who don't live in the city. Now I start to understand, oh, that's why that's happening, or that's why, you know, the government needs to do more. The city government needs to do more to fix it. Now, Catherine, this isn't your first foray into this medium. Tell us about your work with PBS's Frontline, a great program that I'm completely addicted to.
Well, I started at a PBS Frontline production company as an intern in graduate journalism school and then started working there for several years out of graduate school as a reporter, researcher, and then eventually as a co-producer. And it was a great incubator to learn how to marry, I would say, some of the country's best journalism with some of the country's best filmmaking. And I worked under Hedrick Smith, who was the bureau chief for the New York Times in D.C. for a long time, really fabulous reporter and filmmaker. So it was really interesting, and it was a way I hadn't before. My background is more in print journalism, but this really forced you to think more visually about journalism, which is sometimes hard for a lot of us print nerds. But it was helpful. I felt like we had an impact with almost every documentary we did. So it was a lot of fun.
Right, and now you're coming full circle. So you've been reporting for the Baltimore Sun on this certain case that Open Secrets, the mini doc, is going to be about. So just so our listeners get up to date on the story itself, I guess give us the pitch for Open Secrets and tell us how this involves rape kits.
Like you said, for many years, investigated sexual assault in Baltimore City and Baltimore County and how police approached these kind of investigations. And through doing that, I found this really fabulous story of this doctor in Baltimore County who was among the first, if not the first doctor in the nation, to begin saving evidence from sexual assault examinations long before DNA was known among law enforcement. So he just knew that this was something that could possibly find the perpetrator, and I've got to save it. And so he stuck it in his freezer, and he stuck all these specimens in his freezer for 2 decades.
Wow.
It wasn't until the mid-2000s when police started testing these specimens, and they ended up solving a ton of cases, a ton of cold cases, including several serial rapists. And so I thought this would be a wonderful story visually, not just to get at a character, really show this visually how somebody had the scientific foresight to shed light and help a lot of survivors. But also, there's another story in there about a woman, a young woman from Baltimore City, who was raped back in 1983, wasn't believed for a long time, and ended up actually helping to find her perpetrator. So her story is one of persistence, and I think will be really interesting to a lot of people in Baltimore and beyond.
Well, in the spring of last year, I'm really interested to know if you're going to incorporate this into the doc. You reported that a lot of rape kits were destroyed by Baltimore County Police. Had these cases already gone to court and then they just destroyed the kits, or is this like a big scandal? Is it a controversy?
It is a controversy. So the story that I'm focused on in the documentary deals with the evidence that the doctor saved, and okay. That actually preceded what we know as rape kits today. Basically the same thing. I mean, rape kits are evidence that you take from a woman or a man during a sexual assault examination at a hospital. So that can be hair, that can be semen, blood, that kind of thing.
Right.
That is essentially evidence that can be used for a prosecution investigation. But the doctor did it before there were standardized rape kits, as we know today.
Okay.
And we fit all of this into a box. And so fast forward, he retires in the late 1990s. He kept every single thing that he took from a woman's body or a man's body. He saved everything. But after he retired in Baltimore County Police started taking charge of the evidence. And at some point, they set up a procedure where they would destroy certain rape kits after as early as a year. And I found that out when I was a reporter for the Baltimore Sun, because a woman contacted me to tell me that her rape kit had been destroyed.
Mm.
And she was very upset over it because she had been re-triggered by a case in the news and wanted to reopen her case and see if law enforcement could prosecute the guy. And I did not know that rape kits were, you know, that this was a thing, that you could destroy them. I honestly didn't even know that much about rape kits. And so I started digging in and calling various police departments. And I found out that Baltimore County was destroying lots of rape kits every year, while, for example, Montgomery County wasn't destroying any.
Wow.
And there was this kind of patchwork of practices across the state where some police agencies would destroy rape kits on a regular basis after a certain period of time when they didn't think that this case was going to go to trial or that they could solve the case. In other cases, agencies would save them forever because there's no term limits for rape in Maryland.
Or I should didn't
say
know
there's
that.
No statute of limitations.
Right,
there's
yeah,
no statute of limitations
okay.
for rape in Maryland, yeah.
Huh. That just shocks me. I hate to say it, but I didn't even know of that story last year. So where are we? And we'll get back into open secrets, but I'm really interested to know where we are in Baltimore County when it comes to saving evidence for sexual assault.
Baltimore County is now saving everything, as is every agency. After that piece, there's now Senator Shelley Heidelman. She was a delegate at the time, proposed a new state law to keep kits for at least 20 years, and that passed overwhelmingly, and so now every agency has to keep evidence from rape for at least 20 years, and Baltimore County is doing that, and they've also enacted a number of reforms about how they investigate rape, and they have a new head of their special victims unit, so they have turned a new page and are going to be saving everything and testing many more rape kits. And they also just announced, and this gets back to the documentary, they just announced that they're going to be going back into the doctor's old evidence and start to test some more of his DNA evidence, because not all of it has been tested yet.
That's just outstanding. First of all, because this just shows you how important journalism is to everything, whether it's Maryland or the entire country, to bring this stuff to the public, to let them know, and then to enact change if change is needed. And for you to pursue the doctor's story of a guy who is probably going to bring a lot of predators to justice just by holding on to this. It's just amazing. I'm really looking forward to seeing it. So once again, it's called Open Secrets. It's going to be a mini documentary. And what else will you be exploring inside that documentary?
We are going to be exploring what's happening right now. So with the new testing, I'm really curious as to what they find. And we're going to be following police and talking to survivors who are still waiting for their cases to be solved after decades. So that's another storyline that we'll be following and looking forward to seeing what we find out.
So you're still in the production stages, you're still doing the filming, you're still following leads. When do you think the documentary will be made? So, you know, what's next in the process?
Well, we hope to finish it within the year. We started filming late last year, and so we're going to be filming over the coming months and finish it up within, you know, we hope a year. And it depends, like, with a lot of documentaries in which you're following something that's changing on a regular basis. It frankly just depends on what happens with police and their investigation. They, at the same time of having all of these new responsibilities for testing and investigating rape kits and rape investigations, they're also facing a spike in homicides.
Right.
So Baltimore County is under a lot of stress, as is Baltimore City, with just this rampage of violent crime. And so they're having to figure out how to deal with all that right now.
Yeah, you kind of have to just go with the flow. And that's part of making a documentary. I'm sure you kind of have to hurry up and wait and make sure that you're dotting all your I's and crossing all your T's, not to be too cliche about it. So as a 2020 fellow for the Saul Zaentz Innovation Fund, how are they going to help you get the documentary together? Are they? Have they already given you the help you're going to get? Or are they going to help you release it and get it, you know, edited and get it into theaters?
Right now, they're helping me with all of the planning of it and the story, just kind of plotting out the story. And then also with the production of it, with some of the funding of the shoots. And then just connections in the industry, whether it be helping to find music for the documentary or editing, that kind of thing. They help people like me and other new directors. I've produced before. I've never directed before, so this is kind of a new thing for me. They help people like me do this kind of thing. Otherwise, it's really hard to get your foot into this kind of filmmaking world. If you don't have connections in LA and New York and that kind of thing.
It's all in who you know, right?
Right.
So where can people find you and your journalism online?
Well, you can find some of what I've produced on PBS Frontline and the Baltimore Sun even. I've done some videos for them. But if you want to reach me about this in particular, you can go to my Twitter, which is handle C as in Catherine, and then D as in Diane, and then Rentz, R-E-N-T-Z. I also have a website I'm working on, which is CatherineRentz.com. That should be up shortly.
Fantastic. Catherine Rentz is an investigative journalist and a fellow at the Saul Zaentz Innovation Fund. I'll be sure to get all of those links up on our website. And Catherine, thank you so much for not only your hard work in journalism and bringing these difficult stories to light, but going one step further and probably helping out more people who have been affected by this with your documentary, Open Secrets.
Thank you, Amelia.